So the EU watchlist is a representation of the very essence of the work that we do here at Crisis Group. We lift the work of our field experts and analysts to identify cases of crisis which are at risk of escalating or re-escalating, or conflicts that might risk degrading into further violence. In this process, we thought to address our recommendations towards the European Union, because the European Union is a growingly important actor in the field of conflict prevention globally and can use its political, diplomatic, development, security tools and leverages to help mitigate or prevent those conflicts and work with other partners or its own member states to address a solution. Of course, these trends are changing through the year, and this is why we publish an initial watch list at the beginning of the year in three updates, almost quarterly. This is the last update for 2018, and we identify five cases where our analysts looked at two recent developments in Libya, Syria, Ukraine, Nigeria, and Colombia. In the Libyan case, our analysts observed that the recent standoffs between the government of National Accord in the West and its eastern counterparts and the violences in Tripoli were also very much linked to the uneven distribution of wealth and resources to the country. This is why we are encouraging the EU and member states to prioritize the reunification of economic institutions in Libya, starting from the Central Bank of Libya, and also push the government in Tripoli and its eastern counterparts to recompose the other economic institutions. The conference, which Italy will host in Palermo on 12 and 13 November, will provide an opportunity for doing so. In addition to that, we believe that the European Union should enhance its monitoring of the recent economic reforms that the Western government launched, because even though they helped easing the situation and relieving some tensions in the capital, they might also lead to further abuses and reinforce the role of some spoilers for peace. Secondly, we address Syria, where we believe that the EU should continue with its diplomatic engagement to preserve the balance around Idlib, although a very weak one, and preserve the outcomes of the agreement reached in Sochi between Turkey and Russia. The EU should make clear that this balance is also needed for future cooperation with the European Union and the support for reconstruction in case the political process will move on. On the one hand, the European Union should continue finding avenues to reach a political and diplomatic solution with Russia, and on the other, continue supporting Turkey, which already received significant diplomatic backing for this agreement, to ensure its balance. However, they should also be ready for a plan B in case the Sochi agreement will be failing. And so Turkey should be encouraged to work in cooperation with other humanitarian actors, allowing their access in case the world will face the terrible humanitarian catastrophe that we are trying to avert. The third entry in this watchlist is Ukraine. Even though the international attention is focused on the elections upcoming in 2019, our analysts are raising the very important question of the suffering of civilians in eastern Ukraine, in the Donbas. We advise the European Union to look at two very important questions. The first one is the need for Kyiv to release pensions payment to all civilians, irrespective of their status of registrations as internally displaced persons. And secondly, to work for the compensation for the properties that were destructed or damaged through the whole conflict. We believe that the European Union could provide a pooled funding conditioned by the release of legislation in these matters, and that it can work in concert with its member states to facilitate actions in support of civilians in the Donbas. The last two entries of this watch list are Nigeria, where our analysts look at ways of averting violence towards the elections scheduled in early 2019 and the need for the EU and the international community to ensure that they happen peacefully, and Colombia, where we look at the new government's challenges in the implementation of the peace agreement with the FARC, and also the trans-border challenges stressing the country, and especially the consequences of the crisis in Venezuela.